It's time for another Ask Joe Stuff. Okay, let's get started. Sixiradino asks, so I saw a picture saying that bananas share 50% of their DNA with humans. Is this true? Well, yeah, it's kind of true, but probably not in the way that you think. So we know that DNA is made of four different letters or bases, so at any two positions between two genomes, there's just a random 25% chance that they'll be the same. Now, as we look at longer and longer sequences, that chance gets smaller, but it's still not zero. But still, we do share some segments of our genome with the banana because, well, many of the basic mechanisms of life have been conserved between even two distantly related species, like DNA replication machinery or mitochondrial metabolism. And these are things that basically every eukaryote shares. But 50% really isn't that much. I mean, we share more than 98% of our genome with chimpanzees, and look how different we are from them. I know it's an appealing thought, but just comparing percentages of similarity between two genomes doesn't really tell us that much. It's just one small piece of the banana cream pie that is genetics. It's more about the proteins that they make and the tiny amino acid variations between them and when and where they express them. 50% is really quite the split. Meister J asked, why does hearing or being around someone throwing up make someone else feel queasy or throw up? This is called sympathetic vomiting. Congratulations, you have sympathy when it comes to vomiting. I'm sure we've all been there, right? Maybe your friend has one too many tequila shots, or a vicious stomach bug, or goes a little too hardcore at the local county fair pie eating contest, and all of a sudden their body decides that lunch would be a little bit better out in the fresh air. So if you catch a whiff of that, or for some people if you even hear it, then your body decides it wants to join the party. An area of your brain, the vomit control center called the area postrema, takes over and, well, then the vomity cycle begins. Biologists think that this could be an evolutionary adaptation that extends all the way back to the earliest social apes. Early humans would probably eat anything once, but they didn't have a very good way of knowing what was poisonous and what wasn't. So if somebody from your social group eats something and then throws it up, well, that's a good sign that maybe you don't want to eat that. And it could have been a survival technique to, well, blow chunks and live another day. Humans might actually be the only ones who do this. Dogs, for instance, do the opposite. If one of them vomits, then the other ones will just eat it and continue the cycle on down the line. Soup is Ready asked, do you consider the term LUCA correct? Well, LUCA stands for Last Universal Common Ancestor, which is a theoretical organism that's the shared ancestor of all life on Earth, from bacteria to beavers. It's also known as just LUA, or MRCA for most recent common ancestor. Our earliest evidence for life on Earth as we know it now is 3.7 billion year old deposits found in Greenland, or these 3.5 billion year old microbial mats that were discovered in Australia. But all life coming from one organism isn't the only way we could have hypothetically gotten here. We could have had multiple ancestors swapping genes or leading to different domains of life back there in the primordial ooze. But biologists who have modeled these scenarios say that it is 10 to the 2,860 times more likely that we all evolved from one single common ancestor rather than multiple ones. Now, that doesn't mean that our ancestor was the only life form alive back then. It just means that all the other ones died out, which is kind of sad because it makes me wonder what other amazing life could have been out there. Bummer. The Zenith asked, if you could visit any place in the universe, where or what would you visit? Well, although you didn't say so, I'm going to assume that I can travel in time as well as space because, well, this is my show and I get to make the rules. There were a lot of important moments in history, from the Declaration of Independence to other ancient stuff. But if I had to pick one moment to go back and witness with my own eyes, I would go back 2.1 billion years ago and I'd take a microscope so I could watch that exact moment when a cell swallowed a free-floating energetic bacterium to create the mitochondria. This was the origin of all complex life on Earth, every eukaryote, from us to oak trees. This is the single most important moment in life on Earth, and it happened exactly once. I'm gonna put a link to an amazing history of mitochondria and the origin of eukaryotes down in the description. This is an official must read. At Science Eric asks, why is the speed limit of the universe C? And why is my ISP so good at slowing this number down? According to Isaac Asimov, the abbreviation C for the speed of light in a vacuum comes from the Latin word celeritas, but he never said where he got that from, so we have to dig a little bit deeper. C is most famous for being used by Einstein in his famous equation E equals mc squared, but its origin actually goes back all the way to 1856, used as an abbreviation for the speed of light. But many other physicists, like James Clerk Maxwell, were using an uppercase V for the speed of light, and even Einstein used this until 1907. We also know that going back as far as Newton and Galileo, as was the custom, things were written in Latin, so celeritas was used as sort of a generic term for speed, just not in relation to light. There's also a chance it could just stand for constant, which is pretty boring. Either way, once Einstein the patent clerk became Einstein the superstar physicist of relativity, everyone started using C for copycat. As for your ISP, well, I'm sorry, man. There's just some problems even Einstein can't solve. At Janet PhD asks, if you had been given a chance to record greetings to the universe for the Voyager Golden Record, what would you have said? This is an amazing question because it turns out she's an actual voice on the original Voyager Golden Record. She gave the greeting for the Portuguese language. The Golden Record is full of these peaceful, joyful, wonderfully inspiring messages to the universe from nearly every culture on Earth. It's such a huge responsibility to wonder what I would say to our first contact with an intergalactic species, but I've given it a lot of thought. And I don't think I could do any better than this video. Stay curious. Fruits are plants' way of tricking animals into eating their seeds. So while we'll throw this away, for animals, everything goes in, and then later, everything comes out, complete with fertilizer.